Hello and welcome to video lecture series in political science. Today, we are going to discuss chapter 5 titled as Contemporary South Asia from your textbook Contemporary World Politics. Now, for understanding, we have divided this chapter into 6 parts. This chapter is about South Asia. So far, we have discussed about various regions in Asia such as North Asia, South Asia, East Asia, West Asia, Southeast and Central Asian countries. In the previous part, we discussed about SAARC, various objectives and principles of SAARC, and the various areas where SAARC member countries cooperate with each other. We also raised certain questions about why SAARC has not been able to be as effective as other regional organizations. So today, we'll start discussing relationship of India with its each and every neighbor, which together forms as the South Asian subcontinent. Today, we'll discuss about the relationship between Bhutan and India and the relationship between India and Nepal. So let's begin. Now, as we have discussed, Asia is the largest continent in the world, divided between different regions and various countries. It is culturally very diverse, and as the regions indicate, they are rich in diversity. People in these regions have a wide variety of ethnic, religious, linguistic, and cultural affiliations. It is in fact a mosaic or a collage with wide variety of things coming together, yet giving a very beautiful and a rhythmic picture. This region is also very rich in history, and it has a very complex political makeup or fabric. We have discussed about SAARC and why there are reasons for SAARC not being very successful or effective. As we have discussed, that Asia is the largest continent in the world, and we can divide it between different regions. All these regions are rich in diversity. People in these regions have a wide variety of ethnic, religious, linguistics, and cultural affiliations. It is a mosaic. It is a collage, where different pieces are put together, yet there is a beautiful picture that emerges out of these different things. The regions, various regions in Asia, are also rich in history, and they also have a very complex socio-cultural and political makeup. Today, what we'll start doing, we'll start discussing the relationship of India with each one of its neighbors. We have discussed about SAARC previously, and we were trying to identify some reasons that why SAARC has not been able to be as effective as any other regional organization. So let us begin today by our very close neighbor, Bhutan. Now, Bhutan is the closest country with which India has most friendly relations, and this country happens to be no other country than Bhutan itself. The bilateral relations between India and Bhutan have been very cordial and close from a long period of time. Bhutan is landlocked. To a large extent, Bhutan is economically dependent upon India. And Bhutan shares almost 600 kilometers of border with India and has great geographical and socio-cultural proximity with India. Now, as you can see in this map, Bhutan is shown in pink color, and it is surrounded by Indian territory from all these three sides. And on the northern side of Bhutan, we have China, which is the other neighbor. In the year 1910, the British government had signed a treaty with Bhutan. And this treaty, they laid the foundation of relationship between India and Bhutan. What was in this treaty? In this treaty, the British government got power to influence Bhutan's foreign relations and foreign policy. Bhutan was assured of security against any possible threat from any country, or particularly China, which is located in its north. After the British left the Indian subcontinent, the relationship between India and Bhutan continued as ever. Although for a while, Bhutanese were doubtful that India will dominate them. And hence, in order to create a balance, they forged or established alliances with Sikkim and Tibet. But Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, then and the first Prime Minister of India, assured Bhutan of its distinctive identity and autonomy. He said that Bhutan will continue to retain its identity and independence. And on 8th of August 1949, Bhutan and India both signed a treaty of friendship. This treaty of friendship was to assure and maintain peace between two nations and also establish non-interference in each other's internal matters. That is, if something happens in Bhutan, India will not interfere, or something happens in India, Bhutan will not interfere. This is called as mutual non-interference. Bhutan came much closer to India after China annexed Tibet in 1950s, after the fear that China might also annex Bhutan. Although the relations between India and Bhutan have remained very close and friendly, but Bhutan has always expressed a tendency to maintain its sovereignty. Bhutan also joined United Nations in 1971. And this joining of United Nations was seen as a sign or indicator of Bhutan's assertion of independent decision making in the field of foreign affairs. However, Bhutan continued to seek India's guidance in its foreign affairs, and both the nations decided to have close cooperation on foreign and defense affairs. With the Treaty of Friendship with India, Bhutan entered into a very special relationship with India and laid the foundation for a greater assistance for economic development in Bhutan. Bhutan has also withstood India's expectation. Bhutan proved to be India's most trusted friend. What happened in 2003 and 4? The Royal Bhutanese Army carried out military operations called as Operation All Clear and Operation Flush Out against the anti-Indian insurgents of ULFA, United Liberation Front of Assam. ULFA was operating from bases in Bhutan and was using Bhutan's territory to carry out attacks on Indian soil. This operation, carried out by Royal Bhutanese Army against ULFA, has been seen in a very positive light by both the countries. That is, Bhutan has always been a good friend. It has strengthened our relationship. India is Bhutan's largest trading partner also, which accounts for 98% of its export and 90% of its import. India has opened 16 entry points or exit points for Bhutan to carry out trade with other countries also through Indian territory. India is also involved in a large number of hydroelectric power projects in Bhutan. India is also the biggest source of development aid which is given to Bhutan. In 2007, India negotiated a new treaty with Bhutan. Although this treaty changed the provision requiring Thimphu, that is capital of Bhutan, to seek India's guidance in foreign policy, yet Bhutan continues to depend on India on many matters. Bhutan, or this treaty with Bhutan, was replaced with greater sovereignty, and it also said that Bhutan would not require to get India's approval over importing arms in some of the defense matters. But the relationship continues to be growing further. Bhutan's political system has changed from absolute monarchy into a constitutional monarchy. The first general elections for the new political system were held in 2008. India has made an effort to demonstrate that despite India's growing importance in the world stage, the significance of our immediate neighbor, that is Bhutan, remains as always. That is, despite India being appearing as a leader on world stage, India will never forget the kind of close relationship it had with Bhutan. Bhutan will continue to be India's good friend forever. Now let us discuss about yet another neighbor of India in its north, that is Nepal. Nepal is also rich in diversity. It is a multi-ethnic and multilingual society. Nepali is the official language of Nepal as well as the main language of communication between the people. As you can see in this map, Nepal is shown blue in color and it is surrounded by Indian territory from all the three sides in east, west and south. And on the north lies the Tibet. As you can see, this is a detailed map of Nepal showing major cities and the capital Kathmandu, which lies in the center eastern side of the Nepal state. Now, Nepal is located in the Himalayas, north of India. As we have seen in the map, it is also landlocked and surrounded by India from three sides and Tibet on the north. Nepal shares border in the north with People's Republic of China and in the south and west and east by Indian states, particularly Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, West Bengal and Sikkim. And across the Himalayas is Tibet. Nepal has 8 of the world's 10 tallest mountains in the world, including the highest point on the earth, Mount Everest. Hinduism is the main religion and it is practiced by 81.3% of Nepalese, that is of the total population, making it a country with the highest percentage of Hindus in the world. Nepal has witnessed dramatic political changes in the last two decades. Until 1990s, Nepal was a monarchy under the executive control of the king. Now, Nepal is a federal republic with a multi-party system. But this journey or transition from monarchy to constitutional monarchy has not been smooth and easy in Nepal. Let us discuss about Nepal's experiment with democracy. Now, as you know that till 1990, Nepal was a constitutional monarchy under the executive control of the king. But what happened? People desired for a more open system and a responsive government that hears their problems. However, the king continued to maintain and retain control through the use of force and he also delayed adoption of democracy. But after a strong pro-democracy protest during the 1990s against the absolute monarchy, King Birendra, as you can see him in the picture, agreed to large-scale political reforms by creating a parliamentary monarchy. Now, what happens in a parliamentary monarchy? In a parliamentary monarchy, the king remains as the head of the state and an elected prime minister becomes the head of the government. The United People's Movement succeeded to abolish the absolute rule of the king and restore multi-party system in Nepal. The first and free fair elections in Nepal were held in year 1991. In these elections, the Nepali Congress emerged victorious. During the middle of 1990s, the Communist Party of Nepal, who are also called as Maoists, began a violent insurgency in more than 50 of the country's 75 districts. It is estimated that more than 15,000 police people, civilians and the insurgents were killed in the conflict which happened during these years. The Maoists announced a people's war on February 13, 1996 under the slogan, "Let us march ahead on the path of struggle towards establishing the people's rule by wrecking revolutionary ruling system of state." The aim of the Maoist or their aim was to establish a people's democracy in Nepal. The Maoist viewed their struggle as an historical revolt against feudalism, imperialism and called it reformist. But governments in Nepal since then have not been stable and they have not been able to survive for more than 2 years since 1991. Despite being elected, they have fallen either through internal collapse or parliamentary dissolution by the monarch. King Gyanendra again took power back into his hands and established a direct rule. However, the United Movement again in the year 2006, which is also known as in history as April Movement 2006, not only restored parliamentary system but also abolished monarchy and established republic in Nepal. This non-violent movement was led by SPA, that is a 7-party alliance. What were these 7 parties? The 7-party alliance was a coalition of 7 political parties attempting to or seeking to end autocratic rule in the country. What were these parties? These were Nepali Congress, Nepali Congress Democratic, Communist Party of Nepal, Unified Marxist-Leninist as they are called, Nepal Workers and Peasants Party, Nepal Goodwill Party, United Left Front and People's Front. On 23rd of December year 2007, an agreement was made to abolish monarchy, that is remove monarchy and the king, and make country a federal republic with the prime minister being head of the state. The political situation of Nepal is very complex and critical even till date. The process of transition to democracy is not yet complete because they have not been able to come up with a final constitution. The elected constituent assembly is in the process of writing a constitution for Nepal. The problem aggravated when the constitutional assembly was dissolved on June 28, 2012. The dissolution of the constituent assembly without making the constitution was a serious setback for completing the process of establishment of democracy in Nepal. This dissolution of constituent assembly was result of a series of problematic policies and roles on the part of major political parties and organization for years in general and during the period of 4 years of constituent assembly in particular. Some sections in Nepal still think that minimal presence of monarchy is necessary to bring order in society. Whereas although the Maoists have stopped violence, but they demand radical programs to restructure the economic and social institutions in Nepal. But all the parties in 7 parties alliance do not agree with their agenda. There are also problems of mutual suspicion, and Maoists also raise doubts regarding the role of the Indian government in future of Nepal. Now, let us also discuss the relationship between India and Nepal briefly. The relationship between India and Nepal has traditionally been very close and cordial. After independence, India and Nepal initiated a special relationship with signing of the 1950 Indo-Nepal Treaty of Peace and Friendship. This treaty is bilateral treaty, that is between two nations, establishing a close and strategic relationship between India and Nepal. It gives freedom to Nepali and Indian citizens to move across the border into each other's territory without passport or visa, live and work in either of the country, own property or even do business or trade with each other. It also establishes a close relationship and collaboration on the matters of defense and foreign affairs. The relationship between the two countries have been relatively stable and peaceful. India and Nepal cooperate with each other in areas such as natural resources, education, trade, scientific cooperation, electricity, hydroelectric projects, interlocking water management grids, etc. But this relationship also has some elements of dispute or strain pertaining to the issues that concern both the countries. For example, India expressed dissatisfaction or discomfort when Nepal made a friendly move towards China and also at the Nepal's inaction against anti-Indian elements. Indian security agencies also see Maoist groups in Nepal as a security threat to India because there is a rise of Naxalism in various districts of Chhattisgarh, Bihar and North Andhra Pradesh in India. So, they can see an alliance and a security threat among these groups. On the other hand, some groups in Nepal are also doubtful or apprehensive that Indian government interferes in their internal affairs and is attempting to prevent Nepal from getting easy access to sea route for trade. Nevertheless, in spite of these differences, the two countries have maintained healthy relations for a long period of time. One can hope that consolidation of democracy will improve the ties between these two countries further. We should remember that Nepal is strategically located between India and China, and having a healthy relationship between India and Nepal will benefit not only India and Nepal, but the entire South Asian region. So, to conclude, let's summarize what we discussed in this lecture or in this part of the chapter. Today, we discussed about relationship between India and Bhutan and India and Nepal. Both are India's neighbor lying in the north, landlocked by India from 3 sides. We discussed about the politics of Bhutan and Nepal, the process of establishment of democracy in both the countries, their internal situation, their individual relationships with India, including areas of cooperation, and what are the areas or sources of conflict between these two countries. In the next part of this chapter, we'll discuss about relationship of India and Bangladesh. Till then, you can enjoy reading this part of the chapter. Thank you.